My name is Jorn. I worked for, 18 years in Statoil with different things, mainly software development, stuff like that. And as you get older, inevitably turns to architecture and architecting things. Right now, I'm a leading advisor in the drilling and well area for software there. And with me, my two colleagues, is over the Jarle.
My name is Jarle Kallevik. Been only 14 years in the company, so started a bit later than Jorn. And like the other two here, this is my first year at the SATURN. I'm not a software developer guy, more from the infrastructure side and also system integration. Now have the role as a leading advisor for Internet of Things and plant IT infrastructure towards our plants all over.
Yes, my name is Harald. I used to be a leading advisor like Jarle and Jorn, but I'm now finished being a leading advisor. So now I just work with software innovation in our research and technology organization. I've been working for Statoil for 21 years, which is, I don't know how that happened. Must have been an accident. I'm a software developer by background, but for the past 10 years, it's been a lot about architecture. Now, I work with early technology development, and especially how do we architect these R&T systems to make sure that they actually become useful when we get around to using them in the big organization that Statoil is.
So our presentation today, we will try to go through some examples of things we think qualify as Internet of Things, or at least starting to look like that. And in order to do that, we'll have to go through some of the background of the company. I'm sure not all of you have heard of Statoil before, so we're going to do a quick introduction to the company. We'll try to skip all the boring details, but we have to do some of that. We're trying to make that short, as I said. But the main part of today will be discussion around four main things around the IoT space, which we think are especially interesting. So it's a little bit up to you guys today, after we're done with our examples and introductions, to participate. And we'll have to try and use the mic, so I'll try and be handing it around as we come to that. And maybe get Len to help a little bit with that, yeah. So try to get some discussion going on topics as we go along, and so hopefully you guys can help us out a little bit if you find the topics interesting. So with that, I think we'll just go ahead and start with the introductions.
Yeah. So we are Statoil. Not a lot or lots of things to say about Statoil, but the one thing that is important is that Statoil is very technology-driven. All of our or most of our operations are offshore. We are an offshore oil company, and that means that we have always been a technology innovator, and we continue to be that. And our focus is on technology, being a technology developer. Not much to say about this. We are the second largest gas supplier to Europe. We have about 10 billion US dollars in yearly earnings, or at least we did have in 2015, 2016. Lower oil prices, not so much. We'll see. And we are a global company. We have a lot of operations here in the US, especially on onshore oil and gas. But you can also see that we are present in many other countries, which gives us a lot of the challenges that any global company have with the different regulations, the speed of light, which can always be a limit to us, cultural differences, and so on and so on. We thought we'd start off with some of the examples of what we think of as Internet of Things in an industrial setting. Of course, they don't qualify truly as Internet of Things yet, but they're based on the same principles and some of the same technologies and some of the same thinking that goes into Internet of Things. And so therefore we thought that giving you an introduction to some of these things will make the subsequent discussions easier.
Yes, we have 43 plants with some larger scale today. Each of these plants are very autonomous in their systems. We have most of the systems that we need to have to do the production on the site. We have a lot of sensors reading data, thousands of them. And they are giving data every second, 5 seconds, 30 seconds, or per minute. So it depends on what we are measuring. There are a large amount of data every day. Some of them are also high frequent. We are not saving all of these data for a long time. That depends on the usage and how we want to utilize it. Over the last 40 years, we have built and modified our plants. Last 5, 8 to 10 years, we are having most of our data online in historian databases. Most of the infrastructure is hardwired. The last years, we also have been looking at installed wireless instrumentation, but then not for controlling systems, only for monitoring. These data is going up from the temperature or flow measurements to controllers, then to control systems, SCADA systems, and then stored in historian. The operator is looking at these control systems and giving feedback, setting set points to control the plant. So not much of a real Internet of Things, but the data is going forth and back here. However, new instruments on the plants also includes a lot of data we are not utilizing today. And that is something we are looking into. How can we do this, and how do we architecture for such a thing? And then it comes. New plants are not topside systems. It's on the subsurface. It's deep. We can't just dive into it and swim down and do maintenance or do software upgrades. So it's more like when we are talking about NASA doing thing in space. It's really hard to get down to these systems at the bottom of the sea. We can't go out, smell, touch, hear. So we do need to do remote monitoring and remote control. And these systems are placed there for many years to come. So that is something we need to do to think of when we do the architecture thing. We have a
short video that will give you an introduction to this particular field. And if technology is standing by, it actually will work. And it didn't.
Kilometers off the coast of mid-Norway, Statoil has made a quantum leap for value creation and resource utilization on the Norwegian continental shelf. The project started as a mere dream 3 decades ago, but after years of innovation and development with our suppliers and partners, Statoil has now fulfilled this dream. 300 meters below the surface, the world's first subsea gas compressor facility has reached its destination. The pioneering installation, covering an area the size of a football field, could fetch an additional 282 million barrels of oil equivalents from the reservoirs under the seabed. In energy terms, this equals 4 times the yearly hydroelectric power production in Norway, or enough energy to power all households in the United Kingdom for almost a year. Compared to a compressor on a platform, Åsgard subsea compression substantially reduces CO2 emissions and is far more energy efficient. Let's have a look at how it works. As gas is taken out of the reservoir 2,500 meters below the seabed, the pressure decreases and the flow crawls to a halt. The compressor is then installed to actively suck out more gas and condensate from the geological formations. First, the compressor cools the incoming components and separates fluids from gases. The gases are then compressed, cooled once more, and mixed back with the fluids before being pushed to the receiving facility at Åsgard B. To avoid fluid blockage in the pipeline, the compressor maintains required flow at all times. The key to the subsea compressor's efficiency is its proximity to the wells, allowing both sucking from the reservoir and pushing through the pipeline. The subsea gas compressor on Åsgard is also vital to the next step for subsea processing, the complete subsea factory. Constructing self-contained seabed installations will increase safety and efficiency and grant us access to fields that have been unreachable in the past, an important step for our future value creation.
So, and as we move towards these undersea factories, which might sometimes be placed far away from shore, we see that we have to find new ways of sensing things that we today can, send people out to see or hear or touch or smell, preferably not taste. Then we know how to find sensors and analyze the sensor data. So this is from our little test bed for environmental sensing, which is situated in the Lofoten Vesterålen area outside Norway. Then from there comes the fantastic internet address of lovestatoil.com. I got an extra salary raise that year when I came up with the address. And it, of course, it has an integration and test environment called ilovestatoil.com. This is open, so here anyone can go in and see what's happening. So, and it also, in addition to the portal, it also provides a lot of web services that other institutions can hook into so that we can become a part of an ocean observatory network. So we have collaborations with other research institutes that provide us with their data as long as they get our data. And it has cameras and it has various sensors, and it also provides echo sounders, which means that we can sit here and see when the fish is coming in to spawn in Vesterålen. And then we can see that at the local cafes in Vesterålen, the fishermen are sitting there looking at this on their mobile phones. And as soon as they can see something on the screens, we see there is no traffic, but a lot of boat traffic. So it has multiple functions. It all runs on Azure. So it's one of these things where we are seeing that the cloud is really helping us. And it generates about 1 terabyte of data every month. So it's been in operation for about 2 years. And it's becoming quite a small success. Some of you that were here 2 years ago, you might have attended our, Jorn and me, we talked about breaking all the rules. So this is the same portal. We now see that we have all of the things that we told you back then still holds true. And it's become a really good research portal for us. Another interesting example of Internet of Things in Statoil is these intelligent hearing protection devices. So you can see this guy, he is doing something called needle picking, and he is wearing small earplugs, which is connected to a control unit, which he has down on his belt. You can't really see it from this. Oh, you can see it on the top of the picture. And what this does, it collects a lot of sound data. It collects sound exposure from the outside and from the inside of his ear, which gives us the ability to very accurately monitor exactly how much sound exposure this particular worker is exposed to. This is a topic that is very interesting to us because we have now worked diligently for many years trying to get rid of all the people that fall down, drop stuff, put fingers in where they're not supposed to be, and so on and so on and so on. And now we see that hearing loss is emerging as one of the major health risks that remain for us to tackle. And so this is the tool that we have come up with. I have taken this picture. I was there. I was standing right next to him. The challenge with sound exposure monitoring is that today we're using noise maps and normalized data, which means there is a lot of safety barriers and a lot of unknowns in this. At this moment, when I took this picture, it was about 105 decibels of sound in the room, which is quite loud. That's comparable to standing on a jetway. But the thing with this room is that it's subsea, so there are all kinds of interesting resonance effects going on. So when he was moving about 1.5 meter over that way, suddenly it became 117 decibels, which is 10 times as much, even more. And that makes it very difficult for us to monitor how much exposure these workers are actually exposed to, and how that relates to our regulations. The other nice thing about this hearing protection device is that it communicates with a portal. It has a cloud portal that you can upload data. So if I had been wearing this, I could have uploaded all of my data afterwards and see the sound exposure in this room. Wouldn't have been very interesting, but we can follow it minute by minute. So we know exactly how much exposure these people have. And of course, we can get summaries. So here you can see how much exposure they have. And what we're seeing is that the safety barriers, the safety margins that are built in, they are very, very, very pessimistic. And so today, if you're following the traditional regime of hearing protection, you can usually stay in a room for about 2 hours before you have to go out and do something else, which is more quiet. But using these hearing protection devices, where we can see that they are when we have full control over the exposure that they actually have, we can see that they can work full days, and which means 12-hour shifts. And if you can, instead of having four people, replace that with one guy in an offshore rig, that means that you save a lot of money. And of course, we can also follow up the attenuation, which means that we have full control over how well people are using their devices, and we can train them and all kinds of things. And so this very CV-driven project, which has all the things that people like to talk about today, it has the Internet of Things, it has the analytics, it has the big data, because when you do this for thousands and thousands of workers with many different kinds of problems, it gives you all kinds of interesting analytical problems, it's variables, it's HSE, which is very important in the oil and gas industry, and it's cloud. So it's all six buzzwords mixed into one fine project, which makes it a nice project to have on my resume.
So we have, of course, also other things we do on the IoT side. This is just a picture of a drill string, the stuff we use to make holes in the ground. It's you might understand. So what we use here is mostly RFID chips to mark the stands, so we can count how many times they have been used and put it down and up and down of the holes, keep track of the wear and tear of them in a quite crude way, I would say. Simple things like that also helps with finding them, because we have a lot of these. I mean, you can imagine we drill about 10 kilometers on the furthest, and each of these stands is about 27 meters. So there is a lot of these. Also, we do some work on robotics. There is work going on to automate the whole drilling floor, which is assembly of those stands that I just talked about. Putting them all together and putting them down the hole used to be a manual task, and it is still in many places. Trying to automate that by using robots is a big thing. Also projects to do maintenance on our facilities offshore with robots. Those are very early stages, but there are some projects going on with that. There is some work with containers. There is a lot of logistics going on in this field. I mean, the supplies that are involved in keeping the facilities up and running is huge. And then keeping track of where the containers are at each time is quite cumbersome, and so we use some RFID technology there as well, with more or less of a success, I would say. There has been some failures as well, which is, as we all know, important to learn. And of course, there are some personnel tracking using RFID on the facilities themselves to keep track of where everyone is for emergency situations. And there we come into all sorts of interesting problems with laws prohibiting us from basically taking down too much information about people and using it the wrong way. Mm. So I guess that sort of more or less summarizes some of the things that we are up to in this space. So we'll go on to talk a little bit about the architecture of these things and how we look at that. So I guess you'll go on with that.
Yeah. Harald? So there are many ways of talking about the architecture of Internet of Things. In Statoil, we have been talking about something called integrated operations. In the military, it's called networked warfare, which is the same thing. Based on this, we have been discussing something called business capabilities, which, if you have been paying attention, you probably also know from the TOGAF space. So there are a lot of talks about capabilities in this area. And when I work in research and development, I use my capabilities thinking to determine how new technologies and how new opportunities fit into the existing space that we have, to see what kind of other innovations can we come up with when somebody offers new capabilities to us. And capabilities, when I think about them, they consist of people. There are always people involved that are doing things. It's important to make sure that these people have the right knowledge and the right skills and the right motivation to do whatever they're supposed to do. Of course, there's always technology. There are, as we mentioned initially, Statoil is a technology-driven company, so there is a lot of technology there, and a lot of the technology is embedded into our concrete, which gives us a certain set of challenges. It's not that easy to rip out all the cabling on an oil platform. I don't know if anyone have been to see the USS Midway, which is just down the road here, but you can also see there that all the cabling that's basically bolted into place, and if you want to replace one of those cables, well, good luck with that. Of course, there are processes that people are supposed to follow, and these processes are important to us. And of course, there is a certain amount of governance that needs to be in place for a capability to be right. The nice things about these capabilities is that if you have been working in a traditional enterprise architecture space, you know that if you start to look at processes and technologies and information and all kinds of stuff, then it gets really complicated. And if you have a large enterprise, your enterprise architecture gets really complicated really fast. I've worked in the beginning when we worked with enterprise architecture in Statoil, we had like, well, we do still have 3,000 systems, and we have 1,800 processes, and we have 300 information concepts, and we have lots of, and we have people and organization and all the dimensions of a traditional enterprise architecture, and we try to keep that updated. It becomes really cumbersome and really workload intensive. But when you start to group these things into business capabilities, which is kind of a combination, it's a small enterprise architecture that you can think about as one unit, then it becomes easier, because then you can stack them, and then it's more easy to reason about them. So at the beginning, or at the bottom of the Statoil integrated operations business capability stack, you'll find intelligent infrastructures. This is the sensors and the sensor networks and all of these things that we do to collect the data. And it's not only about the technology. If you think about the logistics company, you will see that they have people that are going around waving RFID scanners and moving packets around and doing stuff. And when we do containerized tracking as well, there are people being part of the intelligent infrastructure. And I think that in any Internet of Things setting, there will be people that are part of your sensoring and sensor networks and all of these things. Then, of course, you can collect all of this information, bring it in somewhere where you can view it and collaborate around it. Still more people, still more technology, still more governance and processes on how you do that. And then there is this knowledge sharing and analytics. And this is where we see that the Internet of Things and the availabilities of new technologies can really help us, because it becomes much easier for us, using commodity technologies, to build larger and more complicated sensor networks, which allows us to collect more information, which allows us to learn more things and analyze more things. That, of course, influences our business operations. We can do more things now with our operations than we possibly could have done 10 years ago or 15 years ago without all of these sensors that are now pouring data into our systems. And of course, all of this comes back to the social networks. And when we talk about social networks, we're not talking about Facebook or Twitter or on any of these things, because Facebook and Twitter and such things, they are part of the intelligent infrastructure. They are part of the things that makes the social networks work. They are not social networks in themselves. But the social network is part of the total knowledge that our employees and all our contractors and friends and all of the other people that we interact with have. So by being pretty smart about using the requirements to the architecture is driven downwards. So it's how we want the business operations to work drives the way all the way down to the intelligent infrastructure. What information do we need to collect to have the operations that we want? At the same time, we see that innovation opens up new possibilities for us, so that if we get the ability to collect new information, new sensors, we recently developed a new echo sounder, or we didn't develop, but somebody developed for us, a new echo sounder that gave us much better subsea oil detection, oil leak detection capabilities. So we can now detect oil leaks much more efficiently, much faster, much higher precision than we could earlier. That's part of the infrastructure, and it opens up all kinds of interesting possibilities for us when it comes to subsea factories. And the same thing we see when it comes to the social networks is that if we follow the same processes as everybody else, it makes it much easier for us to recruit staff, to move staff around in the company, and so on and so on. And not having the same, or having the same operations across all our plants, makes it much easier to move people around in the company. But on the other hand, we can also use that as a barrier by having very specialized processes, by having by doing things very specific to Statoil. We can limit the market value of our employees, which means it makes it much more difficult for them to leave. So it goes both ways.
So, as I said, I'm working with the Internet of Things. It's that part of my position is rather new. It is there because we as a company see that this is something we need to learn. What have we done? Where are we today? And how are we going further? Try to put this seven layers of Internet of Things into a perspective here. As mentioned, this things where we have our sensors and devices, controllers, and we also have something called connectivity. These things should be talking to each other. We have some edge computing, our SCADA systems that controls all this stuff, do the calculations that we need to do in real time. So that is also something, if you look at the internet, is calling the fog computing part of it. Then we move data out to our global infrastructure, perhaps to the cloud. We are then going to look at these data together and doing analysis on them. Then you have the big data concept on top of that. To utilize these analyses, we have some applications on top, and we have people and processes, like the business value. However, I like to, in an architecture way, look at it from the top side and down. I don't buy a lot of stuffs at the bottom and then start to think, what I'm going to do with this. You need to take it from the top, see what are we going to do, and then find out what type of information do we need to do this, what kind of applications can solve this. And then at the bottom, we get some things. We also see that today, we like to call it operational technology. It's more like in the automation discipline, not the IT discipline on the plants. They are working with these things, these instruments, and the connectivity and edge computing. And the IT stuff is more above. What we now see and think is that this will move a bit upwards. We see that our vendors that are working in today, this OT side, is delivering solutions moving up in the cloud. Well, that will be interesting when we are talking about some architecture stuff and IT security around this.
So, we are coming into our discussion topic, so now it's up to you guys to stay awake and help out a little bit. I'll hand the mic to Len in a second here. So we have basically four different topics that we're gonna try and engage you guys in, so we'll see how successful we are with this, but it's quite wide-ranging, so bear with us. But we're starting with the data flow here, and I think we're coming to Jarle for that. So we do a quick introduction, and then we try and get some discussion around that.
Yeah. Back to my traditional picture. This is very simplified in a way that to protect IT security part of how it's done in the real world. But we have this equipment on the left side going to some kind of technical system. And we are storing at the local historian database before we are going out in the office network and use support and expert center applications, end user applications to use these data. We also have some vendor expert applications perhaps that connects to the same database to get information. You also see that in the left side there, these technical systems may also control something back. But these systems perhaps will get these kinds of connections in the future. If we are going to move to the real Internet of Things in that perspective, or perhaps this one. And when we then are talking about having good control of this equipment, these controllers, we need to do some barrier thinking, new type of architecturing. Also, the software on these things on the left side is there for 15 or 20 years. So how do we update it? Our plants are running for 6 or 8 years before we are stopping them for maintenance. So we can't just reboot something without thinking new in how we architecture systems, and that goes back to the software development as well. How do we manage these things? Of course, the security up in here will also be an issue.
Yes, so one of the topics that we wanted to hear your thoughts on is the topic of data quality. And I always wanted to say this. So when we go back to the Love portal, which is not the dating site, but our test bed, we can see that we have two different sensors. One is the camera that gives us a picture of the coral reef. This is 250 meters below the surface, so there is no sunlight. So that means that the corals are fairly bleached, but. At the same time, our instruments gives us a turbidity rating of 125 FTU. And if you don't know what turbidity is, and if you don't know what 125 FTU is, let's just say that it's a way of measuring the opacity of the water. So the higher the FTU number is, the less clear the water is. And the sensor can only read until about 125 FTUs, I think. So basically, the sensor is saying that the water is really foggy. At the same time, the camera is showing a very clear water. So, and both the camera and the turbidity sensor is reporting that they are okay. Now, I know why this happens, and that was because there was some animal that decided it wanted to live inside of the turbidity sensor. But we found that out when we picked the whole thing out of the water. We had to pick it out every year for maintenance, and then we found out why we got these readings. But if you look at this, there are two sensors. Both of them are reporting that they are okay, but we can clearly see that one of them is not working. How do we deal with that? Then, of course, if you go back to the sound exposure thing and this little device, it gives me a fairly good reading of how much sound there is. But the way that the sensor works is, I mean, these microphones, they measure sound pressure, which means if I do like this, it explodes. I mean, I get really high readings. Or if I do like this, it gives me I can have no sound around me, and I can do like this, and it reads out 165 decibels, which means if I do this for a minute, I will get this alarm saying, you need to get out. So that's why we need to come up with some kind of algorithm or some way of analyzing the data to see how correct are these data. Because it could be correct. I mean, the way that this thing works, it could have been that there was a really loud bang going on. Because if you drop a container onto the steel deck of the platform, and they are all moving around, and you drop it from 2 meters down on, it makes a really high noise. So it could have been 165 decibels, but it might not have been. So that's so we have a lot of data quality problems, and of course, as we move into the realm of more verbose censoring, we can get these kind of problems. My PC reported that I knew that I needed to renew my public key certificate, so I went to our internal service portal. I put in the search term "renew PKI certificate" because I knew there was something there on how to do this, and I got this, and I got this result. So there is a lot of work that needs to be done to make sure that all of the underlying information and all of the data that we are basing these decisions on have sufficient quality. Because once you start reading, once you get machines to read text and try to make sense of it, you have absolutely no idea what the machine is doing. So that still means that you require people. So these are the sum of the topics that we see around data quality, and we'd be really interested to hear what you are doing to handle these issues.
Questions about data and data quality and sensors at the bottom of the ocean and things like that?
Just the question, you mentioned that you have the edge connections through the cloud. Are you owning actually the connections, or can you influence the quality of the connections between the edge of the cloud and your sensors, or are they going through some public networks?
In the Love Portal example, the edge connectivity and the cloud are public on the public network. So there is it runs over the fiber network, which means that we had to stretch 100 kilometers of cable or so from the backbone and into the wilderness to make it work. And I would assume that in most cases it would run. If it is on a plant, then I assume it would be internal networks. But if you're looking at sensor sites like the ocean observatories and larger sites, then it would be over the public networks. I know that in our land-based scenarios, we use cellular data to move data around. So that gives us a lot of challenges. Mm.
About the data flow, in the picture that you've shown, you have, yes, this one, on the right, something that you call the office network. Yeah. What is it? I mean, the question that I have is about data ownership. And who's, I mean, how can you be sure that you keep being the owner of your data? Because this is an issue that, I mean, we've been facing in our environment. If what you have on the right is a cloud environment, you mentioned Azure in your case, how, you know, I guess my question is, how are you guys ensuring the ownership of the data that you put in whatever environment you have on the right?
Interjection. So there's a broader question embedded in that, which has to do with pedigree of data. So you know, for those of you that are IT centered, the term you might want to look when you do this is pedigree.
Yes. And then I had to look at pedigree of data. In essence, so there are multiple ways of ensuring ownership. In the terms of using Azure, it goes into the end user agreement. Of course, if it's really sensitive data, we might take some other precautions around doing it. In terms of this office network, the office network in this particular drawing is internal to Statoil. So this one is protected by firewalls and all of the traditional mechanisms. When it comes to the hearing protection thing and the hearing protection portal, that runs in the cloud. And it's not a cloud like an Azure cloud where we have control over the servers and infrastructure, but it's actually a software as a service, more similar to your Pulse watch or your Endomundo or whatever. There it's more of a legal problem. So we have contractually ensured that we have the ownership to the data. and with quite severe penalties for the vendor if they decide to do something else for it. Yes. They fail, and then there will be money to pay. Yes.
Next question.
Thank you. I have read a little bit about sound being used to detect faults and flaws and things like that, to so that maintenance becomes easier. Since you talked about sound sensors and all that,
yeah.
Are you also using sound in that manner?
Yeah, we are. So on heavy rotating equipment, motors, engines, we are using different kinds of sensors, like sensing the vibration, the temperature, and so on. Also sound, because some engines are giving some kind of sound when they are good, and when they are measuring differences in the sound, we know that something is going on. So we have expert systems then, so to analyze this.
So you have sound signatures or something like that, and it matches, and then you, and probably the same thing would apply for the human sound also. I imagine there would be some kind of automated patterns that you would recognize. I mean, one of the problems you stated was, how do you make the distinction between something really bad happening versus something normal? So how do you calibrate that, and how do you figure out, you know, this is this and that is that?
Yeah, when it comes to the microphone, the measuring the sound exposure for humans, we compare different channels, because we know that there are some things that are not possible in real life. You can't have 160 decibels on that air and 60 on that, because it just wouldn't work. You can't have a 160 on the inside and 80 on the outside. So there are a lot of different patterns that we have learned through the research and development of these devices. There are a lot of patterns that we have recognized and analyzed that tells us what's what and what kind of data do we need to discard. There are all kinds of interesting topics, so stop by at the office hour and we can discuss it more. But analyzing the data has become much more important, because you can't really trust the sensors outright. You have to analyze them to make sure that they work.
So that sounds like human expertise is required with something.
No,
like that,
no, actually, it's embedded here.
Are you using neural networks and things like that to learn?
No, it's in there. It's in. Inside this plug, there is actually a small microchip that does all of that in real time.
Just to emphasize the point about office hours, so I don't remember when they were, but there is a place and a time when you can go speak directly to the speakers and talk about whatever you want.
Yep.
So I guess to respond to your question earlier, on the topic of data quality, like one of the implementations I have done in the past is, there is a rate at which your data comes from the sensors. Then there is a notion of data quality applied or defined for the data. And of course, like things you're talking about, knowing those patterns and edge cases to flag things to say this data and value coming from the sensor is suspect. Why that's important is then because then upstream, when you are, I'm sure, doing alerts and whatnot, you want to do alerts on high quality data and not low quality data. So how do you know what is a high quality versus low quality? And that's where now there was that notion of, you know, like you're talking about analytics and saying, when you read the data, you have run some pattern matches and you've said this is good, then you do analytics.
Mm-hmm.
I guess the open topic there is, how fast can you do that? Because when I did the implementation, it was more of a, all right, Mr. Field, like the engineer who is looking at the dashboard to say, are things okay? There was an expectation from business that there is a few hours of lag, in some cases 24 hours of lag between when you read the data from the sensor, eventually it made it to your analytics or data cleansing system, all the way up to now when you have responded to it. So probably for you guys, you have to figure out, like in that situation, the first picture, how real time can you quickly figure out the delta between two on the fly, turn it around and say, this is an actionable intelligence and I need to do something, versus, no, this is just nonsense, take it aside. But for us, the key, I guess, to your question was having this centerpiece where you collect the data, you tag information that is high quality versus low quality. How do you tag that? You run some rules on it. But then there is a time delay between consumption of the information from the production of the information.
Jarle, you want to?
I think you have you're into a good question there, and we have seen such problems at our plants where measuring seawater, metal and seawater doesn't fit very well over time. So the measurements are slowly degrading in quality. And how do you know that? Because it's like you're driving your manual shifting car and the clutch is weakening, and you are not sensing that before you are getting a new clutch, and then, wow, what a difference. So we need to see, do we have other sensors nearby measuring something quite else? Then we can start automating how do we analyze that we have a failure on one of them. And that is something we are continuously working with.
So I have a question about moderator's prerogatives. I have a question about the upgrade problem. So there are, to my knowledge, two standard techniques for upgrading sensors that you can't physically access, like on the seafloor. One is the sensor is smart enough to be able to do a real-time upgrade. That technology comes from switching systems like 30 years ago. The other is to have some form of redundancy and have a control mechanism that is smart enough to be able to detect when there's a failure and to switch over. Have you guys given any thought as to how you're going to do that?
When you talk about upgrades, are you talking about upgrading the firmware of the sensor, or are you talking about the actual physical sensors?
No, the physical sensors are difficult to upgrade without actually physically getting there. Yeah. So I'm talking about the firmware.
Yeah. Well, I can speak for the Love Portal. I got to say it again. And in our Love Portal, or in our observatory, we are able to access the sensors remotely through this secure access network, which means that we pull down firmware upgrades and go in and upgrade them. So if you look at the camera, I'm not sure what kind of camera it is these days, but in the beginning it used to be a standard Canon EOS 550D or something like that, which we put down in a housing. So it's very easy to work with, and that also meant that we could go down and do firmware upgrades.
So when you do a firmware upgrade, you're shutting down the camera?
Yeah. The camera only takes photos once an hour, unless so we have plenty of time. When it comes to other sensors, then you get into the problem that that Jarle described. You only get to shut them down once every 8 years.
Then I would suggest that you look at the telephone switching.
Yeah.
Kind of thing.
And I know that there are some of the sensors, they are capable of real-time firmware upgrades.
But then again, if that needs a reboot, then will we get give problems, we need to do both of the techniques you mentioned.
Mm.
Okay, there's a question back there that I interrupted. Yeah.
Okay, you said that you're using the Microsoft Azure Cloud. So are you using the cloud as a storage medium, or the Microsoft provides a specific IoT cloud? So do you use or take advantage of this, so stream processing or anything that's specifically offered by Microsoft for IoT?
In terms of this portal, which lives on Azure, that's just for storing and presenting the data. It was supposed to be a very low budget, very easy, very short-lived system, which has now lived for 4 years. So it, not a lot of thought went into it. I mean, the whole thing costs less than $200,000 to develop and set up, so we haven't really looked into all of these other things. if it decides to become a full-blown full-blown IoT thing, then we'll have to look into it. But then we need to get funding and so on. Yes.
Just maybe I try to answer a little bit this question, which was recently. Different industry, medical devices, but we have also problems with signal quality and connectivity. So we are utilizing actually Azure Stream Analytics for analyzing if the devices are connected and to what extent they are connected, because this is not so obvious that they are connected or not. Sometimes they have in various parts of the world certain patterns for connectivity which we need to analyze. And for, let's say, 1 million devices, you need to have automatic tools for this, and Stream Analytics is good here in this area.
We have to move on because we have other topics, but...
again, I'll refer you to the office hours for carrying on the conversation.
Yes, and I actually think we set up with 2 office hours on Thursday, so we have ample time to come and see us. We'll be there. Okay, when it comes to data storage, Jarle?
Jorn, I think.
Okay. Jorn doesn't have his microphone, so I'll say something about it. No? Yeah.
Yeah, so in terms of data storage, there we already sort of started to touch on it a little bit with the last question there about the cloud. And of course, there are a lot of issues, or what you say, challenges in this area. Where do you store the data? We've already talked a little bit about the amount of data that comes in. I'm sure most of you know a lot about that, the signals and I mean, as the time granularity goes down, of course the more amount of data you have. So this is a nice picture to sort of show the different pieces of what's required in there. And we have a lot of like we show in the data flow picture as well, the operational technology systems more associated with the automation people that are on this side of the drawing, and then we also have the application side, the more traditional IT side on the left here for you guys. So one of the questions here is, as we touched upon here, how much do we store on-premise versus the cloud? There are all sorts of regulations involved in this, like in the hearing aid thing, the privacy of the worker. You could in theory register all their movements. For instance, there is an issue there whether you can track how many hours a day are they actually using their protected gear. You know from the schedule that they're supposed to be outside for 8 hours, and you see they've only worn their headset for 4. So you have all this data that you could potentially use for tracking their movements and seeing lots of stuff. But that's a little bit beside the point here. So in terms of utilizing data storage, I guess we can continue the discussion a little bit in terms of how we use the cloud, what types of things are good to put in the cloud, what types of things do we need to store locally, aggregation of data, stuff like that. Do we do a lot of aggregation before we move the data other places, stuff like that. So feel free to move on to that.
Yeah.
Question time. Questions about data storage and where things live?
Or thoughts. I mean, we're interested to hear what you are thinking, not only our thinking.
This is kind of 2 parts. One is back to the other thing, where given vendors access directly to the sensor, I don't quite understand that, because you were already talking about the data integrity, and so, and you've got other processes in place that are going to reduce some of that noise, so I don't understand why you'd want to give vendors direct access to the data feeds. Secondly, when I look at this, it's kind of similar to some of the stuff that we're looking at from a hospital standpoint of bringing in data, and do you have like a hot and cold path for your data? and I don't know if that makes sense from a hot and cold path. Basically, a hot is basically real time. You're getting it pushed to the front line as quickly as possible, and cold is for long-term storage. So like potential for one of the scenarios we're looking at is a lot of the data that we don't know what to do with yet. It may contain noise, may not contain noise. We put it into cold storage in essence, and then do analysts. But then the other step runs the streaming analytics, and then we push that as quickly to the front line.
Yeah. You want to answer, Jarle, or should I give him some thoughts? I know that since he doesn't say anything, I'll just go ahead. We have the hot and cold thinking as well, because we have the control rooms on the plants, and of course they are part of the OT side of this, so they get data almost immediately. That's the real-time aspect of it. We also have these multi-field operations centers that are onshore, and they get to see the data also as quickly as possible. And we've spent quite a lot of money to put fiber optics between all of our different installations, which means that we can push data quite a lot of data quite quickly. There was one example of the Internet of Things that we didn't mention, which is something called ocean bottom seismic, which is where we have a lot of seismic sensors embedded on the ocean floor to be able to do all kinds of interesting things. And they capture about 10 gigabytes of data every 10 seconds, or 1 gigabyte per second, which we then force feed into the stream, which allows us to, in real time, be able to see that the seismic acquisition is going as it should, and also to see that also to see if there is something happening in the reservoir that we don't like. In terms of the hot and cold, we do the same thing, because we push the data as soon as possible to the seismic analyst, but at the same time we send it off for processing and enhancement in cold storage, which is then used for years afterwards.
As Harald mentioned, and you asked, most of the real-time thing is happening here, but also we have remote operations helping out our plants from a centralized place. They are getting some of the hot data also to the IT side, but are able to connect to these systems remotely. And the other things that we don't know what to do with is going into storage for later use, if being used at all.
To go back to your first question about allowing vendors access to sensors directly, we do that because the vendors are the experts of their own sensors, and with the right processes in place, we can still maintain the integrity of the data. But of course, it's not something that we do. It's not like any sensor, it's not like any vendor can dial up and say, I want to go and talk to my sensor. There are something called work permits and safe job analysis and all kinds of interesting things going on before they are allowed to do that. And then they can either, if it's on one of the big concrete platforms, they can go out and physically access the sensor. If it's subsea, then they do it remotely. But yeah, given the right processes and the right governance, it's not impossible to maintain integrity.
Mixed with a lot of technology that makes barriers.
Yeah, so I have two questions actually. Do I understand correctly that we can say that it's a kind of, you know, pattern, or it's a kind of approach that can be used to you know, for situations when we need to deal with a lot of real-time data? So it looks like on the left side of this slide you are just separating the approach for combining a lot of data, right? And on the right hand you are just, you know, getting this data when you need, integrate them and then analyze, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the second question is, how do you deal with the situation? So how do you try to reduce the volume of data? For example, it doesn't make any sense to store 100,000 of records with the same value for the same device, right?
Yeah.
Any advices?
We have some systems that are, as I mentioned earlier, they are saving high frequent data. So it's a large amount of data in a short time if something happens, like a turbine tripping, stopping because of an error. These systems are made so they are collecting a lot of data for a short period of time. If nothing happens in a normal state, they are just dropping out these data. Yeah, first in, first out principle. If you have a situation where these data may be interesting because of an unknown error, stop or something, these data will be saved. And then you start the normal procedure again. Mm. So, and that happens in this hype.
Yeah, for instance, if you look at things like wellhead data or wellhead pressure, which is a big thing in the oil industry, it usually stays about the same for months and months and months on end. And then, but suddenly, if something happens, it might go up and down. So that means that we coalesce the data into one reading per hour or one reading per day or something, which tells us how the pressure has been. If the pressure has been whatever it was for a whole day, we only keep one value for that day. But if you want to analyze it more thoroughly, we might want to put more into it. I think we have to move on again. Yeah, okay, so then we come to the topic of security. And security is a lot of things. And we know there are some things that are of particular concern to us. One of them is the difference between the EU and the US personal data legislation. I guess most of you are from the US, which means that you live in a regime where the collector of the data owns the data and can do whatever they want with them, in essence. In Europe, it's the other way around, usually. It's the person that the data is about that owns the data. And you can only use the data for the purposes of which it was collected. And that has to be in the agreement between the people that collect it and the people that it is about. And that's one of the... That has a really big software architecture impact. I mean, this is a software architecture conference, so it's not a legal conference. This has a real big software architecture impact, because if you look at this hearing protection thing again, we have to be really, really, really careful about which people get to see which data in which states, because the person that the data is about, he gets to see all of his data. His manager only gets to see one thing, which is how many percentages of his daily allowed dose did this particular individual have yesterday. Nothing about how much he worked, nothing about how many hours he collected data, nothing about his hearing tests. I didn't mention this, but this device can also do hearing tests. So I can, at my convenience, run a hearing test to see how well I can hear today, and compare it to how well I was hearing yesterday. So the manager, of course, can't see any of these data. And medical personnel, they can see other data. And then we have something called industrial hygienists, which can see data on a company scale, detailed data on a company scale, but not tied to individuals. And all of these things tie together to make a really complicated access model, which needs to be really secure, because if we fail, then the EU comes after us and gives us 10% of our turnover in fines, which for an oil company can be quite substantial. So we really have to pay attention to this. And of course, it's this thing about eavesdropping. How do we keep our data confidential? When it's in the plants, it's not that hard because it's all contained. When we move into the cloud, like we were discussing about the Love Portal, it's the way... I said it again, look at me. The way that it works, it has really... really sensitive hydrophones, which the Norwegian Navy doesn't like all that much. So they call us once in a while and say, no, you have to turn your sensors off because we are doing stuff that we don't want you to hear. So we turn them off. of course, but otherwise all the data in this portal is open, so it doesn't, they are not confidential. But if you look at the production data, and especially if you move into the cloud, and somebody once tried to give us a contract saying that yes, we will collect and store and analyze and give you your data, but we will also at the same time reserve the data to reserve the right to do anything else that we would possibly think of with the data. So which meant that they could in theory provide the stock market with a real-time feed of all the production in Statoil. And you can imagine what kind of unintended consequences that would have if our production data suddenly become real-time available to the market. I'm not sure we want to do that. And so that means that there are a lot of security issues that we need to think through when we move into the Internet of Things. And of course, one of the challenges here is that we are combining a lot of different technologies, a lot of different vendors, a lot of different pieces of the puzzle. And all of these things, they open up new attack surfaces to us. And if you, in the old days, it was fairly easy because everything was inside the firewall. And we knew that most people would know how to insert fake transactions into our SAP systems and run off with hundreds of millions of dollars. There were only a few people that could do that. But now everything is opened. So there are a lot of components that are talking to each other. And that means that we have a lot more attack surfaces to secure, which gives us another headache on how we want to do this. And of course, we also want to secure the physical devices. Once again, if you're in the plant, it's very easy because you can, there are, if you want to go offshore to the Norwegian continental shelf, fairly rigorous process. You have to go through training, you have to get space on the helicopter, you have to have a bed on board. So we don't allow anybody on board. But if you look at our shale oil, like we do in, or shale gas, like we do in Marcellus or in Eagle Ford and these areas, there are just enclaves of our technology or our wells, and then there are the public. And so that means that we get exposed to all kinds of interesting challenges when we have people running around our, and it's not like we can secure them physically either, because the, how do you, if you have an oil field that is 90 by 40 kilometers with wells all over it, how do you secure it? It's 1.5 hour drive from one end to the other. Where do you put all the security people and keep the costs down? All kinds of interesting challenges that we want to, because we don't want the, we want to keep the sensor integrity intact, but at the same time, we don't have the money or the manpower to physically have people on each well. So what kind of challenges does that give us?
So do 5 minutes.
So a few questions.
I think this, the sound measurement problem is a really interesting one. If I'm a worker and I have to work a minimum number of hours and maybe I get paid for overtime for anything additional, I might be incented to do one of two things. If I want to work more and make more money, to play with the sensor so that it reports that I'm under my sound quota. If I want to leave work early and get paid for a full day, I might be incented to manipulate the sensor data so that I reach my quota early.
Yeah, and that's not very difficult because that's just 2 days.
Right. So
1 minute of that and you can go home.
With the privacy environment you described, what kind of ability do you have to do fraud detection about worker manipulation of the sensors?
The very short answer, nothing. We can't do anything. On the other hand, the offshore community, very tight, very transparent. Any slackers, they are known. We know who they are. We know that they're not working. We can't do anything about it. Giving them this piece of hardware doesn't really change anything. So it's not like in our industry, it's not that it's not that important. But it gives us the ability to protect people. People will always exploit the system. And I think that over time we will learn how to deal with it. But at the moment we don't know because we don't have any measurements or anything to do with it.
Uh, Well, I guess part of that was he stole my question, but because I think this mixing a little bit of privacy and security, right? Because as you said, there are differences in the European Union and the U.S. Because here in the U.S., as long as you, I think as long as you can actually guarantee privacy, right, you can sell the data. But if you have, if you can be the one actually having access to these devices collecting data, right, there are many companies or industries that are right there just ready to use the data.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is also you have to first secure the access and then guarantee that basically it's anonymous, right? In the U.S., in the European Union, it seems like, well, how do you distinguish really privacy and security? Seems very mixed.
Yeah, and as I said, I'm not a privacy advocate or a privacy lawyer or anything. I just know that the differences between the EU and the U.S. gives us all kinds of interesting software architecture challenges that we need to tackle, because the data needs to be kept confidential, not only from outsiders, but from all of the insiders that could also possibly be interested in the data. And in Norway, where we work, there is also very strong labor unions. And the labor unions probably would not look favorably upon anybody trying to introduce instrumentation that would allow us to tell how much workers are working. So we are actually hiding a lot of data from anyone. But they are there, so we can access them, but it's just there are very strict regulations, so it's a legal protection. There is not a technical, or there is technical protections as well, but the main protections are legal. Mm. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, so I'm sure we could have discussed security for another hour as well, but we want to get the final topic in. We've touched a little bit upon it before in the presentation. It's analytics, which in my mind is you know kind of the crux of the whole situation. I mean, if you gather a lot of data like we do, and you don't use it for the greater good or for creating some business value, then what's the point, right? So many times we feel like this guy here standing in front of a huge maze trying to figure out what kind of data do we have and what can we do with it. There are all sorts of initiatives going on trying to figure out, you know, we're trying to organize things with semantic web notation, semantic web, stuff like this. But we have a Also, like we were sort of hinting to before, we have a lot of data quality issues that makes data analytics difficult. But most often, it's just because we don't know what we have. I mean, we have this picture here. I'm not sure all our systems look like this, but at least some of them do. And you can imagine it's pretty hard to find anything useful in here. At least you have to spend some time doing it. So this is kind of the situation we have every day, trying to create business value for our customers.
And as you know, if this had happened to be your loft, you would know where everything was, because you have a tidy mind, so you can keep your data all scrambled. But if I have to go into his loft to find stuff in his loft, that's when the real problem occurs.
Yeah, and these type of situations are not created in a day, right? They are created over 40 years, like we say, we have history, and that's how you get into this thing. But there are also some other interesting bits and pieces in this puzzle as well, which
yes, I don't want to talk because about. If you go back to this portal, in addition to the portal itself, It provides a number of services where you can go in and fetch data. And we were discussing how do we wanted to make the data available and what we want to tell them about. And then this was some years ago, and the semantic web was the thing. And so one of our collaborators, he introduced us to semantic webs and ontologies and stuff. And then we started out with this. This was the key to the whole understanding of ocean sensor data. And I'll just let you read it for a few seconds. And you can see it absolutely does not help you in any way possible to infer what kind of data we are supposed to. But this is, I mean, if you look at the semantic web and the ontologists, they are always trying to structure things. And I used to say there were three kinds of people in this world, and there are people that get things done. They're usually developers. And then there are people that like to analyze things before they go and get things done. Those could be called architects. And then, of course, you have the ontologists, or the people that want to come up with a common model of the model and the model itself before they go and get things done.
The meta model of the meta model.
And so we spent a lot of discussion. I spent 3 days in a dark room, wet towel over my head, trying to discuss with some ontologists what this was about. We finally agreed on this. This is from the ISO, I think it's from the ISO 15926 standard, which is the semantic standard for information. This is where we tie all our drill string information into the possible individuals. But what are we trying to do? Well, we're trying to give data context. So if I were to give you a number, it wouldn't really tell you anything. This is sensor. Sensor reports 8. But we don't really know what this 8 is. And then, of course, I know, since I know what it is, I know that this is 8 centimeters per second. Still doesn't tell you a lot, but it might tell you something. Something is moving slowly. And then I will give you another number, which might not be related, which is 120. And I know that this is 120 degrees. And due to the limitations of the slide, I won't tell you if it's magnetic or true north. So then you can see I have something which has a speed and a direction. That now it's starting to make a lot of sense. And then I would give you this. If you're into geographical information systems, you probably recognize at once that this is UTM coordinates. Otherwise, I'd tell you that this was UTM coordinates. This is our office location in Trondheim, or outside our office in Trondheim. And I would also tell you that this is collected using an ADCP. And that, if you are in the ocean observatory business, that is enough to tell you that this is a current measure. So this measure ocean currents. So what we have done in the portal is to develop something that we call the Statoil Integrated Environmental Monitoring Vocabulary, which is where we define all the things that we describe all our sensors, and we describe all of the things that we have put down there, saying that this is a Canon EOS 550D, and if you want to know more about it, you can go over there and read about it. Then we have tied all of our terms and the things into open vocabularies. Like, there is something called an environmental monitoring vocabulary. There is something called a semantic sensor network vocabulary. Measures and units, so that you know that my centimeters are the same as your centimeters. And of course, if you want to work in UTMs and geopositioning, you have to tie into the VGS 84 geopositioning vocabulary, and which of course also ties into each other. And by doing all of this, we are able to tell you in a machine-readable form that these are our measurements, this is what all of this means, which means that if you read our data, we can also tell you what those data are, and we can tell you the sensor state, and we can tell you all kinds of things in terms that your machines can talk to our machines and make this happen. This, of course, also has a software architecture implication, because you need to put this one into your software architecture. You need a triple store, and you need a some other components there. But in terms of the Internet of Things, we believe, or I believe, I don't know if you believe, but I believe, that this is one of the things that will give us much headache in the years to come, because we'll have lots of sensor readings that we have absolutely no idea what they are, where they came from, what are the instruments, and so on and so on. And so using this approach of a lightweight open data, open linked data approach, we are able to give the data some context, but not a lot of context.
So we can do a quick 5 minutes on if anyone has some more stories where this was missing in analytics, or if you have some great successes with it, or stuff like that, or anything related to analytics.
Quick comment. So what you did was develop an ontology.
Yes.
No, because ontology has a lot of formal requirements, but if you call it a vocabulary, you get away from all of the ontology people. No, I don't want to be an ontologist. Turn the camera off.
Questions, comments?
I'm just kidding.
Other than collecting data from many of these devices, do you do some decision making based on the data and invoke an action on these devices? And in case those actions are very critical, with a poor networking or distributed failures, how does it all work together?
Yes, we make decisions based on the data, but it's still humans that make the decisions. We don't have a lot of autonomous systems going around. We will be, one of the things, if you remember back to the video, you remember the subsea factory, because the subsea factory will have to be more or less autonomous, because it needs to be able to function without the connection to shore. Today, if you lose the connection to shore, the whole thing just shuts down. But you might want to keep it running on a steady state if you have to, but then it has to recognize when it has to shut down. And that's one of the areas that we are working on. We are aiming for it. At the moment, it's a lot of humans that are involved.
So one last question.
I have a question about how do you identify your devices? So I believe that ID of the device is really important, especially if you are not sending any semantic information from the sensor itself, if you are sending just 8s and 9s. So what is your approach, what is your strategy in getting a device an ID, and what information you can get from this single ID?
Today we are using a tag system. It's every item on the plants are tagged with a unique number, unique for that plant though. So you can find two items in different plants having the same ID, but then we are tagging some extra information around that to tell what plant this is. So we have a standard for how to do that. However, some numbers and letters are not telling outsiders what this actually is. So there, this model comes.
As long as we have this OT bar, if your data is not going to our direction, we can send a reprocess, add some read data, add some context to it. But if you will start being right there to your vendors, like the brokers, and then you can how will you like about it?
Well, we still have to give them IDs. IDs.
So
yes.
The microphone wasn't at the questioner. So the question was that would work as long as all the data goes through software owned by Statoil. What happens if a vendor directly accesses the data?
Yes. In our ocean observatory, the sensors still have IDs, but they then of course. We use the IDs to tie them into these different vocabularies. And in Statoil, we have this thing called an engineering numbering system, which is what Jarle described, adding more in front of it to distinguish between the different plants would still give us that unique idea, or ID, not idea. I think we will continue to use our engineering approach, at least for the time being.
So these days the vendor gets an IPv6 address and that's tagged on all the information?
I don't think that's the point. I think that it's about the context of the sensor.
Okay.
Geographic location, ownership, calibration.
All of those things are in the vocabulary that we
right. So it's
Because all of the sensors have a unique URI that you can use to access them, and based on that URI, you can also pull all of the semantic information about them.
So the question really was not so much what sensor is it, but what context does it have?
Hmm.
Okay, so we've run out of time, and we've had a great discussion, and I refer you again to the office hours. In the meantime, thank you for.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.